Hello again. In this video we will be installing an abutment gutter, or abutment soaker as they're sometimes known, to this leaking single overlapping tiled roof. Now normally a step and cover flashing like this would be waterproof on a profile tile roof like this. But if I just zoom the camera out for a moment, you can see that the roof doesn't abut the neighbour's property and make a true 90 degree angle. In fact, if I just Photoshop a 90 degree angle in, you can see that a bit clearer. And it's this angle here that's causing the leak and compromising the flashings. Because the roof tile is profiled, it encourages water to flow between the humps of the roof tiles like this. And normally, this is a good thing. Unfortunately, because next door's wall nibs into our roof, you can see that the water flows under the covering flashings and onto the undersarking underneath. Although it's not a great deal of water, over the course of a decade or less, it will eventually either rot the undersarking or find a way in, leaving the homeowner with a nasty little surprise. Long-term solution here is to fit an abutment soaker like this one. Now this is a GRP fiberglass abutment soaker, and I will provide common examples and sizes on my website if you need them. You can find these in the links at the end of the video or in the description bar. Traditionally, roofers used to make their own abutment soakers from rolls of lead by overlapping sections like this, and this can still be very useful to do in awkward situations. In fact, if you want to, you can substitute the GRP soaker out completely and use lead instead. The majority though these days tend to be GRP because it's fast, light, cheap and easy to use. Okay, the first thing to do is strip off any fouling ridge tiles at the top of the roof. So it's up with a roof crawler or cat ladder to get started. Over the years, one of the easiest methods of ridge tile removal I have found is to gently hammer a slot head screwdriver between the ridge tile and the mortar bed. As long as you're careful, eventually a separation forms, allowing easy removal without smashing anything or any need for a diamond cutter. Once the ridge tiles are off, you can apply the exact same technique to removing any mortar bonded to the roof tiles themselves. And when that's done, the tiles are clean and ready to be stripped. All I'm doing now is gently folding the flashings up and out of the way. I'm not looking to damage these in any way. While they may not be waterproof on their own, they will provide a nice aesthetic finish to the roof afterwards and hide the abutment soaker underneath when it's completed. Now we have full access to the roof tiles and we can start to strip them off. It's always a good idea to number the tiles like this on the underneath and stack them in some sort of logical order as you go. It's never funny to have a confusing jigsaw left on your hands at the end of the day. Then it's just a matter of working your way down the roof to the bottom. Remember, you're not stripping the whole roof here, just enough to get the abutment soaker in with the minimum fuss and faff. As a matter of interest, if we look at the undersarking, you can see the path the rainwater has taken down the felt, slowly becoming a larger amount of water near the bottom, resulting in the leak. Now we're in a position where we can start thinking about fitting the abutment soaker. But, as happens quite often, the roof battens poke too far forward to allow the lowest part of the soaker, the gutter, to sit below the height of the roof battens. Let's just look at a couple of common examples with Photoshop to try and explain this a little bit better. This is a common example of what I'm trying to explain. Here I'm fitting yet another abutment soaker, this one with a nice square roof and wall. Underneath the tiles we can see that the rafters or trusses are square and parallel with next door's wall. And in this Photoshop mock-up I will turn the roofing felt transparent so that we can see the rafters more clearly underneath. In some cases you will be lucky and the rafters underneath the roof sit back from the neighbouring wall like this. Then, after simply cutting off the batten ends, the roof will accept the deepest part of the abutment soaker without any complications at all. Sometimes though, you're unlucky, and the rafters sit flush with next door's wall. This means the rafter or truss beneath will foul the deepest part of the soaker, and the battens are fixed to the rafter itself. What you can do in these cases is to provide an extra rafter or small support batten from the inside of the loft fixed into the timber. This will allow you to refix the tile battens into your new support timber to provide support for the roof tiles later on. Now you can cut off the fouling part of the tile battens and you have enough room to seat your abutment soaker once again. Back on our job, we have this funny shaped angle nib. Not only that, but the loft space inside has also been converted. So that means no access from inside the loft without serious cost implications. Luckily, these roof battens are strong, in good condition, and if we fix the GRP valley board into any floating batten ends, this should provide adequate support without any real problems. What I'm going to do now is trim off any long batten ends to the minimum amount so they accept my GRP soaker. Always measure your GRP soaker and allow an extra 2 to 3 millimeters of width to allow for expansion and contraction. This will stop possible damage and creaking and groaning noises later on. Now it's just a matter of marking any offending battens for cutting. For me, the multi-tool or multi-cutter is the best tool here. I find I can cut the timber easily, even in cramped conditions, without damaging any felt or membrane underneath. Now you should have some sort of clean run ready to accept the abutment soaker. I've measured and cut the soaker again with the multi-tool. Here is the soaker loosely fitted into place and ready for fixing. Notice here at the bottom I've deliberately left a space. This is so I can beat some lead as a transitional piece that converts from the shape of the GRP soaker to the profile of the tiles below. This isn't always a necessary step, but in this case it is. Back at ground level and with a section of GRP as a template, all I'm going to do now is copy the same profile but in lead, in much the same way that lead abutment soakers can be made individually if you want to do that. Here you can see the end result. You don't actually need any special tools for this really. The lead can simply be bent over any accommodating offcuts of wood that you have lying around. As you can see here, I've removed the GRP soaker and placed the lead in its final position. It's now just a job of gently bossing the lead into position. I'll be using a lead bossing stick for this, but if you haven't got one and you're patient, the bottom of a rubber ended hammer will also do the trick for you. Often it helps to trim any flashing returns down slightly, rather than try to beat them round any corners in a fully uncut state. Finally, I've created an upturn roll on the edge of the lead here to provide extra strength to this already very strong lead. If your lead seems like it needs extra support, or you will be placing heavy mortar on it at a later stage, additional support battens can be added across the rafters and fixed into them under the lead like this. Now is a good time to treat the lead with a little bit of patination oil. This will help to stop unsightly white streaking from carbonisation running down your tiles or roof at a later stage. Now with the GRP soaker back in place, you can see exactly how this has come together to form a conversion between the two profiles. Sometimes, of course, you don't need any lead work at all. On this other roof, as you can see, the abutment soaker can sit straight onto the brickwork or fascia and deposit directly into the guttering beneath. GRP can now be final fixed into position into the tile battens. If we zoom back out, you can see that we are now ready to tile the roof back up. In this situation, I won't be applying any mortar to the bonding strip located here, but you can if you want to. This is for no other reason than my personal judgment call. Over the years, I have found that often mortar placed here with good intention cannot be finished correctly or becomes crushed, potentially blocking the very gutter that you have just fitted. But it's my job and my guarantee, so that's why in this situation you will not see a mortar bed being installed here. At long last, we can finally get back to refitting the roof tiles, which should be straightforward apart from one small problem. Any small cut tiles like this one may have batten lugs that are unable to fix to the batten underneath because the abutment soaker is now fouling it. If this is the case, and you can almost guarantee it with at least one or two tiles, simply take the offending tile, turn it over and cut off the fouling lug. Now it's just a matter of drilling a new fixing hole where it won't puncture the waterproofing of the GRP soaker. Over the years I've found a cordless hammer action drill to be about right for this delicate job, and as long as you use a small diameter masonry bit and you're a little patient, you shouldn't smash the tile. Here is the cut tile fixed into position. If you look closely, you can see the missing lug allows the tile to sit nice and flat, and the new nail fixing does not puncture any part of the GRP soaker used for waterproofing purposes. Now I'm simply going to tile the roof back up in the same fashion all the way to the top of the roof. Once that's done, we can gently tap the cover flashings back into place. Finally, I'll rebed the ridge tiles back into position with a nice strong mortar mix and rub some patination oil all over the lead work just to make it look a bit better in the coming months. And there we are, done. As you can see, the roof looks exactly the same as it did before we started, and you virtually wouldn't know that any work had taken place, which is why these are often referred to as a secret gutter. If you do need to learn any of the other skills seen in this video, like removing tiles, mixing cement, or creating lead flashings, please click the links here or in the description bar. Well, that brings another video to an end. I hope this has been useful in some way. Thanks for watching.